countless centuries, Haida canoes plied these waters, and the songs of the first people mingled with the many voices of the raven. Then, for a silent century, the raven was alone. Today, that unnatural silence has been broken by the sounds of the young voices of those who take part in an adventure called Rediscovery. From all over the Queen Charlotte Islands, they fly here in noisy machines that shatter for a moment the quiet of a land of unmatched beauty. The sight of this, the most isolated youth camp in the world. Here, the extended family of the old Haidas is recreated in a place where past and future meet.
I think all our children in Masset appreciate the camp that they've been going to, where you learn more about the heritage of trees and all sorts of things that God had put on this earth for us to enjoy. Both my grandchildren and my sons have taken part each summer, and it's an integrated camp where whomever, non-native or whoever wishes to go to the camp, they are accepted. And I think that's great for our native children. Even though we know in this day and age that there's no such thing as discrimination, I used to surely feel it when I was a girl. There was discrimination between white and natives. Through camps like Rediscovery, they learn to be together. They learn to share.
And we're going to have a real good time out here the next 2 weeks. There's a lot of workshops we're going to be doing, and hikes and backpack trips, and learning a lot about ourselves and nature. And this is an eagle feather, and it's a special, very special feather because it's a talking feather. And we're going to pass this around the room and let each of you introduce yourselves to the whole group here and to tell a little bit about yourselves, what you'd like to do here while you're out here the next 2 weeks. And we'll just let each of you have a chance to talk. My name is Huckleberry. I've been working on the program since 1978 when it started. And I built this cabin 10 years ago that you're sitting in. And a lot of people have passed through here. And I'll pass it over here to Delbert.
My name is Delbert Davis. This is my third time out Rediscovery, and I am your junior counselor.
Robert Samuels from Haida. That's it. The second time out here.
I am Mark Zahn from Sandspit. It's my first time out here.
I'm Ethan McKay from Tooele. It's my second time out here, and I want to do kayaking.
My name is David Suffren. I am a camp supervisor, and I have a case full of wits to make sure that you do the dishes and
That's good. That's important.
Oh, thank you.
I'm Blake Jones from Haida. My third year, and I'm your volunteer worker.
My name is Ian Wood, and this is my first time out here, and I'm 13.
I'm Sean Donnelly from Queen Charlotte City, first time out here.
Hey! Hey, I got ripped off!
Hey!
Oh, no!
No!
Oh, no!
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 No! No!
It's amazing how hard.
You certainly see the kids open up a lot more by the end of the program. When they first start and the eagle feathers passed around, often a lot of them will have nothing to say. And by the end of the program, some of them will have an awful lot to say, and other ones that haven't said anything will come out with things you would never expect from them. And Native kids off the reserve seem to have very different needs from your average white middle class child. To let a child know that he's got a place there, that he's got as much right to speak as the next man, and that everybody should listen to him just as they listen to everybody else, I think is a really important gift to give a child. I mean, that's confidence. That's going to give him some confidence that's going to go with him all his life. You know, give him a chance to stand up for what he believes, to find out what he believes and follow it through.
Take Leon, for example. Leon never used to talk at all. He came out to ReDiscovery for the first year. And he just started talking. Then the second year he came out, he was talking again. And then this year he's come out, and now he's asking for the talking feather twice over.
Sometimes he comes across a bit too strongly, you know, he's demanding and ordering people around, but at least he's asserting himself. He's saying, hey, I'm here, everybody. I mean, listen to me, I've got something to say. And I mean, yeah, he obviously does. You see it in his drawings and everything. He's got a lot to say.
This is a picture of Houston when it was up before 100 years ago. And this is one of those longhouses that are in its nighttime, and it's there's a totem pole beside it, and in front of it, and there's a mortuary pole beside it with bones in it.
There's nothing to do for the kids in Massett except hang out at the arcade or else get drunk. When I was a teacher, they say, Mr. Suffering, they say, we learn more at ReDiscovery in 2 weeks than we ever learned at school.
As I sit here on a rock looking out to sea, I wonder how nature made such a beautiful place. Everything seems to be living. Even the rocks form shapes of living things. As I sit here not twitching or moving an inch, I feel I am part of this beautiful place.
And in 1774, the first contact between Europeans and native people on the west coast of Canada took place right there. A Spanish explorer by the name of Juan Perez came all the way up from San Blas, Mexico. This island behind him there is only 500 feet high, and yet that was the first body of land that was sighted and recorded by a European north of Monterey, California. And he came in here, and the Haidas immediately went out in their dugout canoes, and they were amazed to see this ship with sails on it. They had never seen people that looked like this before, that had the white skin, that had so much iron on their boats. A short while after that, there was a lot more traders coming in here, and there was a whole bonanza in sea otter pelts that was realized in that bay by Captain George Dixon. He came in on a boat called the Queen Charlotte. He was the first to circumnavigate these islands. He named this group of islands the Queen Charlotte Islands after his boat and his queen.
The first people name is Kawarstas. Kawarstas. And after that, other people start moving in with them. And they used to trapping all over the west coast, up the inlet, everywhere. When the Hudson Bay got starting to buy the furs, the Hudson Bay people used to make those musket guns. They put the gun up like this, and they make the people pile their fur up and up to them. When they did that, these people see how the people were doing that, they sent word to where they make the guns and make the guns longer. But today you can't do that to Indians now, because they're all educated. You can't cheat Indians anymore.
So much land that hasn't been under treaty yet, and that right now they're in the process of getting the miners in here as fast as they can, and the logging. And all we did was told them we are the Aboriginal sovereign authority, and we have the right and we have a responsibility to make sure that our heritage keeps on.
Hardly even made a dent.
Oh, mine made a dent.
I'm wearing this one now more than that one.
Mine made a dent.
Okay.
Attempts to recreate moments from the past at least give some insight into the diverse abilities of the old Haidas, who within the narrow limits of their universe were truly universal men and women. In 2 weeks, it's impossible even to begin to restore these skills, to rediscover the techniques necessary to create beautiful and practical objects, to learn the songs and stories told of the mythical beginnings and long histories of the peoples, the ranking and ordering which gave their lives the structure and purpose that defined their roles in the community. It's been over a century since Kiusta was a thriving community where people lived rich, colorful lives and the great families competed for prestige. Only a few remnants of this extravagant artistic display remain. And the skills of those who were its creators have in the generations between then and now been almost entirely eroded away. It was the complete knowledge of their language and culture which enabled the survivors of the great plagues of the 19th century to carry on in the face of a world changed in every way by the influence of the Europeans.
It's good for the younger people, the younger Haidas, to learn the culture that's just about been lost amongst all these old longhouses that have rotted and fallen down. I think that it brings something back to them.
It's not as if we're trying to hold on to the past or anything like that. It's a matter of holding on to the future and holding on to the present day things that we have. It's not an old thing, it's still here. So it doesn't matter what number or kind of date they put on it. Those are mortuary poles over there, and here, people buried inside of it. Part of the beauty of totem poles is to watch them on their way back into the earth. And the ones that have been preserved have certainly been useful. But the ones that are going down, they're the ones that are the most magnificent ones to see.
I live in Victoria. Oh, I got a brother of mine who's Native Indian. He was adopted by my parents when he was 4. Well, my parents wanted my 12-year-old brother, Carl, to go to ReDiscovery and discover about how the Indian people live. They asked me if I wanted to go too. And at first I said no because I figured that I'd be the odd man out. I'd be picked on being in an all-Indian camp. They took me down to a slideshow at the Native Friendship Center. I watched it and I decided that I really wanted to go.
Here they encounter, often for the first time, the wonderful completeness of the truly natural world, whose complex relationships reawaken the youthful curiosity and desire to know.
So we looked at grazers, these are grazers, and we looked at filter feeders. This is a barnacle, is a filter feeder, so is this. So is the razor clam, this cockle. This is a horse clam, they're down pretty deep. These guys normally don't prey on horse clams, but they do prey on butter clams. And they get up on the clam here and they drill a little hole through the clam and they stick in this long proboscis they have. It's like a ton, and they can digest it right out. Filter feeders, grazers, and then there's carnivores.
Supper time!
The hamburger culture that we all know so well, you don't ever get much of an opportunity to ever clean fish or do anything like that. And a lot of the kids come out here and their cravings for arcades and pizzas and stuff like that, the junk food is what they really want.
You know, those big red titans.
Yeah. I had to take my boots off to get it.
This chitin and those big red ones. We call that red ones in our language eight. Eight.
Eight?
Eight.
The Yoki police say that when a spruce needle fell to the forest floor, the deer could hear it, the eel could see it, and the bear could smell it. To help you learn how to hear better, we're going to play this little game called Deer Ears. We're going to blindfold one of you and put a cloth tail in your back pocket. The rest of you will become predators, cougars or wolves. If you predators get close enough to snatch the cloth tail from the deer is dead. But if the deer hears you coming and points directly at you and says starve, then you're out of the game.
Starve. Sir.
Yeah.
Try and find as many different things that you can, and you can list them all down. So it can be like you can have two different types of moss, so that's two things. You can have a twig, that might be one thing.
Or you just put down the numbers or what?
Just put down what you see in there.
Do you have to write it?
Yeah. If you want some help, I'll give you help.
I need help.
I hear, I forget. I see, I remember. I do. And I understand.
You'll each have a cocktail glass, and you can pick anything at all that you think smells nice, and any combination of forest smells that you think go well together.
What's a moist grass?
Well, some of them have little cracks. We're going to call you all together for judging, and we're going to judge it both on the basis of smell and on the basis of composition.
Gag me.
Keep going.
Fragrant.
Okay. Mm. Entry number three.
Come on.
Somebody tickle his nose.
Very unusual, actually.
The winner is...
For the smell, I think number two.
Number two.
Beautiful.
Carl
fragrance.
Wins for fragrance.
Was it Carl?
Yes, it was Carl's. Like, we've had a chance to see the forest and to touch it and to smell it and even taste it a little bit. But now we're going to have an opportunity to totally become a part of this forest.
Oh, yeah, you bury yourself.
Yeah, we're going to sort of do a thing, we call it moss windows. Some kids have had some real neat experiences doing this. One kid had a little mosquito land on the moss above his eyes, and it spread its wings out. And he was looking through the wings of this mosquito about 150 feet up to these treetops, and he could see an eagle circling up in the opening there.
A six-day, 55-kilometer backpacking expedition along the rugged west coast of the Charlottes is for most young people the greatest physical and emotional challenge they have ever faced in their lives. The isolation, physical and mental exertion, result in a heightened awareness of themselves, their fellows, and the land.
When you relate to the land in this kind of way, you're relating to it in the way that the old people did. You got to take the hard times along with the good times.
Tomorrow, when we go on the hike further south down the Triple Pass, you'll see a shaman burial.
Oh, yeah, I saw that 2 times.
If you look at this stuff, it's nothing but wood ash, periwinkles. They must have eaten periwinkles by the billions.
What are we having for supper?
I'm not cooking nothing for you guys. He wouldn't wait up for me. I told you it took 10 minutes. Okay, I'll cook.
What do you want me to cook?
Potatoes. You can make corned beef hash.
Yeah, corned beef hash.
Potatoes, onion, garlic, and
corned beef hash.
You took Johnny, eh?
Danny, first come, first serve.
Oh, I never checked it off.
Didn't check it off.
Somebody else checked it off.
Yeah, you guys can all save your teeth for a few days. Yeah, just go straight back through here as a trail. Eat them up, move them out.
Eat them up. Move them out. Yeah. I'm gonna go through the rock.
See you guys. A Haida person could go down to Vancouver or Prince Rupert or somewhere and boast of his ancestry. But in a situation like this, he's pretty well on his own. He's gotta prove himself out, same as any other one of the kids.
So I thought it'd be real nice just to pass the eagle feather around, let everybody say how they feel about things and stuff.
Well, I just like to say it's, instead of down in Beresford, it's my first experience of being with the group, learning a lot, speaking up more.
I've never hiked that far before. I wish I found an eagle feather, though. But
I stumbled all the way at the back with Mackie, crawled the last bit of the beach. So how I got over the cliff, I don't remember that part.
I learned that 35 miles can be really hard on your feet. And I learned that seafood isn't that bad, cooked or not cooked.
I really had fun on the hike. It was kind of different. I didn't expect something like that. Kind of wet. And I would like to thank Jeff and Blake and all those guys for looking after us when we were out there.
Being able to go up to your waist in two rivers and then hike another, 12 miles. It's pretty excellent.
I didn't like it when it was raining at Beresford. It was so bum. Getting all wet and all that. But I like hiking back. It was good. I like sleeping in the cave.
So you'll get 2 matches tomorrow. You'll get 1 raw potato. You'll each be taken to a spot, and you'll be about a mile apart from each other. Sometimes for people, the hardest thing is not being alone in the dark. It's not being isolated. It's just being with themselves for 24 hours. Some people don't know themselves very well, and they don't like themselves. And it's hard to be with a person you don't know well or don't like. So it can be a real important learning experience in your life.
Robert Samuels, I live in Haida, BC. I'm 13 years old. It's solo. Solo, it's seeing if you can be alone, see what it's like to be alone and without much food and living by yourself, see what you can do. I have 3 brothers and 1 sister. No, I have no mom. I got a dad. He's in Rupert, and I have a guardian looking after me.
You thought about things, like respect nature or something? Like, so you can see some of the things people do to it. Like clear-cut logging and pollution, oil spill. Just kind of thought about that myself. Yeah, no. Just wrote poems. That was kind of give fun, too. Just kind of had a fire going up, but kept me out, I think. Having a fire kind of gives you heat, warmth, security. Chase off all the bad animals that are chasing you.
Leon Ridley, a massive BC. Like coming out in. Like walking in the forest and looking at birds. Like people teaching me and drawing nature things and all that, like eagle and all that. It was good out here, like the solo. It was tough, but I survived.
Ceremony night is a fitting climax to ReDiscovery. Even the most introverted are carried away by the spirit of the evening. Gift-giving, speeches, songs, and dances look back to the Haida potlatch traditions recreated around the ceremonial fire. For all who have embarked on this remarkable voyage of discovery, it marks not an end, but the celebration of a journey through life that has just begun. Thank you.